Okay. Welcome back. It's been a while since we've been on the air here. Today we're going to talk about implicit bias and blame, or moral responsibility for implicit bias. For this one, we read a series of articles published in philosophical journals. There were four big ones. One called Praise, Blame, and the Whole Self by Naomi Arpley and Timothy Schroeder. Another one, Responsibility for Implicit Bias by Holroyd. Another one called Racial Cognition and the Ethics of Implicit Bias by Daniel Kelly and Erica Rotter. And there's a last one, Blame and Responsiveness to Moral Reason, Are Psychopaths Blameworthy by Matthew Talbert.
Before that, too, we covered two other articles.
Yes.
The Frankfurt article and why am I blanking on it? Charles Taylor's
article on human agency.
Human agency.
And then, of course, the Frankfurt one is Freedom of the Will and the Concept of a Person. Seminal article. So, but very applicable to what we're talking about here today.
So, yeah, let's get the people in on what we're talking about there. So, I don't know, someone want to read the thought experiment? Because this could get it all running. Like, what are we talking about, implicit bias? Why are we talking about this? Is this just more useless jibber-jabber? No, it's a very real problem. So, what kind of a problem are we talking about?
All right. Well, yeah, let's just get this out of the way, definitely. So here's just a thought experiment to get you in the mood. It goes like this. Oops. Oh, no. Judith is a well-respected academic who doesn't mark students' work anonymously. During one semester, a student accuses her of favoring Western-sounding names in her marking practice and giving those essays higher marks. Judith is dismayed. She would never dream of this. She believes she treats everyone equally and without prejudice. To clear her name, she takes an implicit association test, IAT, which measures implicit bias. After taking this test, it turns out that Judith does show a bias toward Western-sounding names. Upset, she decides to mark anonymously in the future. Later, Judith is talking to her friends about this experience, and they reassure her that she is not to blame for her marking bias. But Judith is unsure. Why isn't she to blame? After all, it was she who read the work and marked it. What do you think? Do you think Judith is to blame? All right. So this is what we're after. We're after these, I guess for lack of better words, unconscious bias. So this is not explicit bias. This woman who's marking the test, Judith, she's not consciously trying to do it, but unconsciously she's preferencing certain groups, or races or genders or whatever.
So if anything we say tonight is racist or sexist, remember it's not us that are racist and sexist. It's our views.
Oh, God, you're already stepping into that. You're getting into that.
Well, it's the views that are racist and sexist, not us.
That was mentioned in one of the articles, by the way. So okay, so let's get into this. Should we start with what was when you read this? What was your gut feeling about Judith? By the way, what did you think about Judith being to blame for marking your paper before you read the articles? Just when you read the thought experiment, what was your first reaction?
My first reaction was I felt like she was doing something wrong, but I felt difficult to blame her morally for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I immediately started going off in insane directions. And I thought, okay, whether or not she is to blame is irrelevant. The question is whether or not she deserves to be punished.
Duh. So she could be punished but not be blameworthy, you mean?
Yes. Well, yeah, I mean, she could be punished and not be blameworthy, or vice versa, she would be blameworthy but not warrant punished. The actually application of this thought experiment, I mean, it just lies in the realm of blame. It's On the level of blame, I was not getting any real feelings to one side or the other. It was like, okay, especially when he, in the article in question, he goes on and talks about the explicit racist. In which case, my mainly thought was, okay, whether or not we blame them is not so much the point as whether or not there's intervention or penalties for their actions.
You mean like the implicit person?
Versus the explicit person. Mm-hmm. So when I thought when we levied the critique against the implicit person, against Judith,
yeah.
Yeah. And she says, oh, crap, and actually...
Yeah.
She takes her little responsible step. Whether or not she is the blame is not an issue. She took... It was obvious there was not the implicit intention and she even went as far as to take correctional methods. And so this is not like a situation where the university should step in and say, okay, we're doing whatever sanctions we do against people who take this action. Whereas the explicit racist, I think, would be say, if you were to say, of course, I'm immediately assuming this is a guy, because of my implicit bias. Yes, but he was.
His name is Jim, too.
You're right. And so yes, if Mr. Sterling were to be like,
no, Jim, no.
What if Jim were to be like, it's not that I have a bias against Western names. It's just, Western people are inherently stupid. But then I think this is somewhere the university might have to say, okay, something needs to be done here.
Yeah, but poor Jim, no one ever edumacated him.
Yeah,
He's never encountered anyone that ever told him that what he was saying is wrong. His parents, when he was a little baby, were singing racist songs. That's how he goes to sleep at night. He just plays a good racist chant. And then he closes his eyes to sleep into sweet dreams of racism.
I need to download that CD at the racist chant one.
But, I mean, he's never encountered anyone that told him otherwise, and he's been educated completely in this culture of racism. So you're still down on Jim?
Well, I don't know. I was getting a little bit...
You never told him otherwise.
Yeah.
I was having Kaufman flashbacks. And it's like blame and desert are a little bit different, but I was thinking these punishments were not necessarily assigned based on the capacity for change, capacity for thoughts, is what do we need to do to keep social order? Where with Jim, his actions are in a realm that at least in our current society. Need to be very strongly discouraged.
But I mean, like, implicit bias you would be against as well, wouldn't you?
I would be against, yes.
Yeah, and it needs to be discouraged if possible, too, doesn't it?
Is Jim a bad person?
Bad? Okay, now you're...
Yeah, is he morally bad?
Is he morally bad?
Even Jim a free pass. All right.
Jim's the explicit one. Jim's the explicit racist. Right?
Exactly.
He was never educated, right?
He's never educated. He's explicitly racist. Yeah. So pretend you're going down to some place. I don't know why I'm saying down again. Dustin's bias here. you're going up to some place and
up in the north. No.
Up in the north, and it's just this totally racist yuppie, and. Trying to mix it up a little bit here. I mean, this totally racist yuppie. You're not going to morally condemn that yuppie for being totally racist against Canadians. Or, I don't know, whoever this is. But they're totally racist. They hate Mexicans just so much. They're going to make Mexicans build a wall or something. I don't know what he's going to do. But, I mean, like, so this whatever this guy, whoever this guy is or girl is, make it a girl. She's totally racist against Mexicans. Like, you don't morally blame her. So your only concern is you're like a robot. You're kind of like, well, It's unfortunate you have these views, but I'd rather punish you. I don't really care. I like that.
Yeah, it's like it's not whether this person is a good or bad person. It's their views are falling against the order that we're trying to maintain as a society.
Yeah, but what if Jim never actually acts on his racism? This woman never acts on her racism. She just keeps it all bottled up, and well, she talks to you about it.
Over a couple beers.
Yeah, a couple of beers. Every day she's like just screaming on the inside, God, I hate this plurality and this democracy. Ugh. Why can't it all just be white people?
Well, then I guess,
but she never acts on it.
Then I have zero problems.
Oh, she doesn't deserve to be punished then.
She's
just fine. Okay, cool.
Yeah, she doesn't have... so long as it's not influencing her actions. But I don't really think then she's really racist. It's enough.
Oh, she's not racist. Enough. Okay.
If she's not out there, you know, she's still at a point where she has the ability to...
Levels.
She needs to be more racist. It's not a sentence you often hear. I like it. She's going to ramp it up a little.
Well, if your actions, if your beliefs aren't translating to actions, then what are they?
Okay, so the explicit racist is bad because his beliefs make his actions racist. That's the implicit person does that too, by the way. The implicit person's actions are motivated by a kind of a unconscious bias.
Yeah.
Nuts.
No, but I think there might be a distinction to draw between the two people. The implicit racist. Well, the person with implicit bias and the explicit racist.
There you go.
I do want to talk about that.
I loved how all these papers really danced around that. Like a lot of the wording in some of the papers was they really jumped around calling the implicit person racist.
Yeah, they didn't want to do that because they're chicken.
So chicken.
They're all losers. They're losers. They're garbage. They're all chickens.
Is this your Donald Trump moment here?
Why we have to talk about this? This is something that I don't know. I thought about it for a while, and I kind of feel like I've come to accept it, but it's difficult, I think. So I don't know, let's get into implicit bias. So I mean, like, first of all, we have to talk about, I guess, maybe implicit bias is can you be morally responsible for something that you don't have control of, quote unquote, or is implicit bias bad? Anyway, right? I mean, you have to maybe even have to start even as simple as there. Like, for example, now Dustin. No, it's not use me. Jim.
Jim again.
Jim again. Jim is just my go-to guy for racism. Jim walks up to me and says, "Well, Dustin, I've looked at the statistics books because I love statistics. I sleep with my stat book every night. And according to the stat books, black people are more likely to commit murder. So my bias that black people and guns are associated and black people are dangerous is actually rationally justified. What's wrong with my bias? Like, why? Why is that a bad thing that, you know, I have an implicit bias that black people are dangerous? The facts bear me out, man. You know, just look at the murder rate, per capita murder rate, and, you know, it's just a fact. We'll just pretend this is a fact by now. For the sake of argument, he's right. For the sake of argument, he's right. Black people just simply commit more murders on average than white people. So he says, well, Dustin, when I walk away from them on the street at night or I won't let them in my cab, well, that's just me being safe. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? And I don't want them, you know, working at my place because, you know, if I have a choice between the two, I'd want to choose the safer one. What's wrong with that?
Yeah. This guy. Okay, this came up in this racial cognition and ethics of implicit bias paper.
Don't we have to start there? Like, is implicit bias bad or not? Right? I mean, for example, I have an implicit bias that snakes are bad. Or I also have an implicit bias that the sun is hot. or you know, like knives are dangerous items. Yeah, so, you know, like, you should really be careful around knives. They're sharp and they're dangerous. Mm. And I often associate knives with death and blood. Mm. So, you know, but I think there's a big difference between knives are dangerous and black people are dangerous. Mm. Okay, but we have to understand why. Why is one okay and one not okay?
Yeah.
So we have to start there, right? Because knives are dangerous, right? But I have the stats now, or Jim has the stats. And he's telling you now, he's telling both of you, black people are more dangerous. Black people are dangerous. I have the statistics. So, you know, black people are kind of like knives.
In Jim's mind, yeah.
In Jim's mind. they're kind of like knives. So what do you say back to Jim? what do you tell him?
if we want to go with just the stock throwback, you know, cutting straight to the point.
Cut straight to the point.
Yes. You know, all knives... are dangerous. Yes, I'm sorry. All knives are dangerous. Yes, not all black people are. I can stab somebody to death with a butter knife.
Is it irrational that Jim has this bias?
Your alter ego is coming on, Dustin.
Oh my god. Hey, I took that implicit bias test. Hey, I came up pretty good on that, by the way.
Actually, me too.
But is it irrational when Jim says he associates black people with danger?
I'm gonna jump in on this. Like, this actually came up in one of the articles, and it's weird. Like, the author really danced around the issue a little bit, and I'm just gonna go straight and say, this one, the one with the black people are dangerous, is irrational. But the one, knives are dangerous, is not irrational.
Okay, and, good. Of course. Why?
And okay, I guess I just want to just throw two things out. First, like, black people are dangerous. Like, this implicit bias is all about association of concepts in your mind, right? And black people are dangerous is associating... black people are dangerous because they're black. You know what I mean? Like, this is an irrational association, right? Knives are dangerous. I think is more rational because that's the nature of the knife, right? But the blackness of black people has nothing to do with any kind of danger. They're not dangerous because they're black. I mean, this is the irrational conjoining of the two concepts.
Okay, so it's almost as if the knife has a certain facticity.
Yeah.
And black people have a certain transcendence. Right? The knives are incapable of transcending the nature of what they are, and black people are because they're human beings, right? Is that what you're telling me right here? Like,
well, yeah, I mean, even that, or like, even that would be like a weird analogy for me, just simply in the sense that, like, for example, if we're thinking about crime, I think it could be more easily associated with factors like things like poverty or education, right? Things like this. Not about the nature of the person themselves per se, but like the environment that people are located in and things like this. I mean, the association of, if you're going to associate danger with any of these things, the blackness of the skin is not the rational thing to associate it with.
Let me make my racist a little more sneakier.
Okay.
Okay, now this, the racist is sneakier. It's like, well, I don't think black people are inherently dangerous. Maybe it's not. Maybe I don't know about that. Lord knows. But the fact of the matter is, they are statistically more dangerous. So now there's two guys applying for a job. Yeah, I don't want that black guy.
Okay, then I do want to pull in this other half that you already mentioned, which is this, what you called, like, transcendence. Like, this almost, like, reminded me of what we talked about with Camus. And this came up in one of the articles, like, that associating a human being with a concept like this is ignoring all the facts about them. Like, it's leaving something out. How did this person phrase it? I can't remember, but I really liked it because it, like, Camus flashed in my mind really, really quickly. There's a remainder, right?
That's what he said.
There was a remainder. Like, it's something that concept can't capture about the person. And I think that... I do think that is an irrational way to, yeah. to view it.
Right. I mean, isn't my sneaky racist? He's. I mean, like the thing I'm first tempted to say is that rationale, like they said in the article a little bit, like rationality can be immoral, right? In other words, that kind of calculating rationality, where I just show you the stats and say, well, black people, what you gonna do? That kind of calculating rationality can be immoral, but I don't know. I don't take such a down view on rationality. I just think that that's an incomplete assessment of the situation, right? Like something is not being accounted for in this utilitarian kind of how can a dank calculation. of the world. Maybe I should just call this dank calculation. Like this is just total dank calculation. Where you just list these kind of superficial facts and assume that one equates to the other. For example, I just want to ask you the question: like, when it comes to prejudice, isn't there a big difference between, or at least even data? There's a big difference between data about a people. And data about a person, right?
Definitely.
Right. I mean, like for example, you can say, you know, almost matter-of-factly, black people commit more crimes, but you can never say that about the individual person that makes that up, right? I mean, just stat-wise, right? I mean, there's something like you can't take these high-level trends that are just trends among populations. You can't ever reduce that down to the individual person. And I think these people are saying that it's immoral to do that, too. Like, what this article about, what is the...
Oh God, racial cognition.
Racial cognition was saying that, like, it's immoral to reduce people down to this kind of factual calculation. What, I don't know, black people are dangerous, Mexicans are rapists, whatever you want to say, you know, I know he didn't say that. I know he didn't say that. Well, let's just say that there's another girl over here and she's saying that right now. Like, I mean, like, the stats are in. Mexicans are rapists. I mean, like, there's this bridge between stats about people or big trends and stats about and facts about individual people. Like, a people is a concept. It's just a concept. But individuals are transcendent in a way that factoids are not. And maybe, I don't know, like, this article, I know, this is where it starts to get weird. Like, you almost have to kind of, you have to realize the, like, okay, so this is where it starts to get weird for me is, okay, so.
It's weird in a lot of places, this article.
Yeah, like, I mean, but, oh, but not just that one. Like, this one links in very well with the very, very well-researched one, which is the, sorry, I'm going to blank on these names. Hang on a second. The Jules.
Oh, Holroyd.
Holroyd one.
Yeah. Responsibility for implicit bias.
Responsibility for implicit bias. I mean, he's saying like, just like these people said, like, and the psychopath guy said, like, look, you maintain your racism in the face of evidence that should convince you otherwise. Shows you to be kind of having, well, I love the phrase, have a motivated irrationality, right? But my question to you is this, like, this is where, like, they don't start to mix, they don't start to work. They're saying, like, look, I mean, like, you should know better. You should know better when you see these things. This is your motivated irrationality that's keeping you racist. But my question is, what evidence? What evidence is telling these people that black people aren't dangerous? What is that evidence? What is the evidence that they're saying, well, you guys should have known better? What's that? What is the evidence that says black people aren't murderers?
You mean, like, what are these racist people kind of motivated to ignore?
Yeah. Or okay. What are they not seeing? Like, because the people that say, well, you shouldn't have these biases are saying, like, well, I mean, isn't it obvious? You're just not looking at the evidence. They're not. But, I mean, I'm sure the sneaky racist would say the opposite. He's like, no, man. The facts are on my side. I have the evidence. You've got nothing. You've got a bunch of, like, my buddy is black. And that ain't nothing to me, man. I got the data. So what's this evidence you're talking about? Like, what is the evidence that we should not do these racist acts, right? What is the evidence that they're missing? That's my question. I mean, because that's gonna be the answer as to why implicit biases are bad about groups. Associations are bad about groups. I'm just trying to make it clear about why is it that, I mean, like, why is it that we're even talking about this?
Yeah. Okay.
I think it has something to do with exactly what we just said.
Yeah. Okay, like, what if, boy. So what if we bring it back to this really odd point in this racial cognition article that came up that it made me stop and think for a while at the very least. This guy says like these parents with a daughter Eliza.
Yeah.
She comes home from school and she got a test that like she did really poorly on, and I guess he kind of says like there's evidence to suggest. Now you have evidence to suggest that Eliza is dumb, right? She's a third grader, and she walks home with a bunch of tests, and she got poor grades on all the tests. And now you have, I guess, some evidence to suggest your daughter is dumb. And then some people might get up and say, like, yeah, that's it. These are rational reasons to believe my daughter is dumb. And he accuses these parents of making a kind of moral violation, in the sense that he said like they have like a moral duty to give their daughter the benefit of the doubt. Yeah. But I kind of when I read this, he was like, yeah, it might be rational. I was like, really? It doesn't sound rational to me. It sounds like it's leaving so much out. You know what I mean? Like, there's so many factors being left out just to get a couple of tests, third grade tests, and then say like Eliza is dumb. That's just like leaping far too quickly to conclusions. You need to take into so much more into account to figure out what's going on. Why is she getting these bad scores on their tests before any amount of bad tests is rational evidence to conclude she's dumb.
Okay, so. What you're kind of saying is that we were just taking this back into the black person realm. Okay, that sounded weird, but poorly phrased. But you know what I'm saying.
Just like I said, if any of our views expressed is the views that are racist, not us. So please go on.
Yeah. But,
so you know, I'm the guy who has his little stats. That's these theoretical stats that prove. Indecisively, the black people commit more crimes. I'm similarly making a leap from those stats. That's to the guy who's interviewing for a waiter position. Jim will commit crimes.
Hmm.
Yeah, you're making that leap, and like, I don't like. This is weird when it comes to the daughter too. Like, I didn't like what they wrote at all. I just found it was ridiculous. But I get what they're trying to say.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, like, he's like, oh my god, they have a moral obligation to believe.
The best of their daughter.
The conclusion that is most kind. Okay, yeah. Sorry, that's not morality. Mm. It's not moral to be kind all the time.
I thought that was really weird. I thought, like, the ridiculous. Most moral thing to believe about your daughter would be what would help her the most.
Yeah, not the most kind thing.
Exactly right. So, I mean, if by some really good, I don't know, something, some convincing thing says Eliza needs help, I think you have a moral duty to help her. You know what I mean? Like, not to just kind of ignore the evidence and assume she's all okay. But I just think, like, it's irrational just to assume she's dumb.
Exactly.
That's the irrational.
Like, what the parents are able to do is they're able to see more than the teachers can see.
Exactly. Yeah. The teachers can't see much about Eliza at all, really. Just a little bit.
And there's something about all of us that, I mean, not even, that only we kind of know, right? Which is our potential. I can't ever really see all of your potential because when I look at you, I only see the facticity of what you are, and I have to make judgments about that. But maybe the more I know you, the more I can see that you have these certain potentials and you're either acting out of character or you're not. But there's this kind of space around you that's not clearly visible on first glance about who or what you are, right? But the thing is, you know it. Like, most of all, you know your own transcendence. Like, you know that, like, you know, everyone's saying, like, well, I act like, oh, I'm just a waiter, but I'm so much more than a waiter. Or, I work here, but I'm so much more than that. People are viciously aware of their own transcendence, but they also deny it, like, on an extreme right to everyone else. They have transcendence, but they reduce everyone else to the facticity of history, stats, data, right? But I guess the trick is you have to be able to keep that sense of your own transcendence and give it to someone else. You have to see the glimmer of their transcendence in their eyes somehow and keep that possibility open.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but I don't know. This all sounds so flighty because, like, sometimes people really do need help. But anyway.
Yeah. But I think it's not enough. That's not enough evidence by any means to come to these kind of wild conclusions. I don't even see where you get off the ground with that. If you're going to make that explicit connection, right? But I guess the problem comes in when your mind is slowly making these implicit connections without you knowing it. Our first point was like, this is just bad because we're kind of, by doing this, we're actually leaving out a very fundamental aspect of other people around us. We're actually denying a fundamental aspect of them or missing a fundamental aspect of them when we put these kind of implicit biases on them.
Yeah, I mean, this is just a kind of something that doesn't get transferred from big data down to the individual level.
Yeah.
Something doesn't mix all the way down, right? I mean, And people know that very well when it's about them.
Yeah.
But when it's about someone else, that's when the story starts changing. Like, well, you're one of those, right?
Yeah.
Right. But about themselves, oh, they're very aware. Like, well, yeah, I live here, but I don't like these guys at all. Like, I'm not like that.
Right? Yeah.
Okay, so there's just this kind of, I don't know, I just wanted to get across that, like, maybe some of this is bad, because I know the first thing that people are going to say is, I mean, this is the kind of the, I don't know, the strident reaction back. The
internet racist.
Yeah, the internet racist.
All the time to Google all the stats, right?
Yeah, I mean, the internet racist has got all the stats. And, like, to those stats, I can say, well, you're probably right. I'm not a statistician, so maybe you've got a couple wrong. But I guess that's not where we have to fight the battle. Like, even if the racist comes up and, he, you know, and I saw the stats all about, you know, black people and murder rate after all that, you know, the police and the killing and stuff in America. Like, I saw all the crime stats, and I'm a sucker for stats, I admit it, because God knows, I don't even know it's real anymore. And, like, I have to rely on numbers, but numbers don't even tell the truth. But that's the first thing the internet racist is going to tell you. He's going to tell you all about numbers. And you're going to have to basically accept the numbers, but fight the battle. I think you have to fight the battle somewhere else. Because to deny the numbers is just simply, I don't know. You're gonna start off on the wrong foot, right? Just accept it. Accept that, but don't give in.
I mean, it shouldn't even matter if those numbers are correct.
It
still shouldn't justify doing what these people are doing.
Yeah, it shouldn't, but that's what they're going to do. That's the first step, though. Like,
yeah.
I am the guy with the secret truth.
Yeah.
No, the media never tells you this. Bam.
Yeah. There's always a couple of those.
Right. That's the first step. Anyway, so, like, that's, but, and speaking of first steps, that's the first step in this argument, right? Like, what's wrong with implicit bias, right? I mean, like, because I don't think people get past the first step. Right? I mean, like, people are going to start fighting back right here, at least as far as I see.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, no. Like, I've seen all the peoples, I've seen the, you know, like, well, Stefan Molyneux told me that racial IQ correlates to income earned, and therefore, you know, the races with the highest IQ have the highest income earned on average, and so therefore we know basically where you fall on the IQ scale. Asians being the best, whites being the third, Hasidic Jews, I believe, being the second. And then it goes down from there. I mean, like, okay, so, yeah, we got all this data, and, you know, Stefan Molyneux spent hours compiling the data and writing it up and putting it on nice little spreadsheets. And but, I don't know, okay, yeah, what can I say? He's probably right. I mean, we can fight the battle on so many levels there. What is IQ? There's a reason why this stuff is happening. But I don't know. Hey, I can even say, like, I grant you all of that. And yet, right? And yet. There's no reason to... the reason why you would want to get rid of these implicit biases is on an individual level, this doesn't work anymore. Okay, so I don't know. I just want to get that out of the way. Maybe listening to too much Stefan Molyneux.
Wow.
Yeah, I never thought I'd say that.
I know. That's not often a sentence you hear.
No, not a sentence I often want to say either. So, makes me want to vomit a little bit in my mouth. But I'm, okay, moving on before I get hated for this. I'm sorry, Free Domain Radio. I'm so sorry.
Moving on. You'll still be listening.
Yeah, I'm still going to listen. Of course I'm going to listen. moving on. So this is, I'm sorry, I had to stop us here, but this is an important step.
It is important. Yeah, why would you get rid of it if it's not wrong to have it?
Right. I mean,
it would just be a rational approach to dealing with people. I mean, in a weird way, even Paul Bloom sometimes makes a weird kind of gesture in this direction. Like, these exist because of experiences and things like this. I think you said that once.
Well, they kind of do.
Yeah, right? I mean, all these kind of associations you put together in your mind. All right. Okay, let's just dive into the second one then, since we delve so far in the deep end, the first one. Step two, I mean, now you have all these implicit biases. I don't know. I think a lot of people's first reaction is, well, it's not in my control. Why is this my problem? You know what I mean? Like, I'm not doing it. I'm not to blame. There's nothing... It would be wrong to say somebody is to blame for having something like this. You're just born into, like, America or wherever. And
you know, like, it feels like the battle still is, like, fought just before this level, right? I mean, like, before we get to the guy that's, like, this kind of, this, like, kind of self-hating liberal that lives with a kind of guilt complex, which they actually recommended in the essay.
They did.
Be humble and guilty, my friends, and live your life with a faith in humanity. I was kind of like... I was cringing. I'm sorry.
Activate your motivation.
I'm activating my motivation. But the battle isn't fought here yet, is it? Okay, first we got through the first step. Mm-hmm. The first step is, what's wrong with biases if they're true? The next step that they're going to fight is, I don't have bias. Like, okay, yeah. Maybe biases are bad, but I'm just giving you the truth, bitch. Right, like, boom, see, this is my gendered word right there, already.
Oh, okay, we're doing that.
We have to, because that would be the next step they're going to tell you is that. I mean, they're going to say, like, I'm just telling you like it is, right? Yeah. I don't have prejudice. How do you know I have prejudice? All right.
This is where we're going to bring in the IAT here? Is this what we're going to do? Like, so the implicit aptitude test, which we all took, by the way, it claims, you know, if you look into it, this thing is not without its controversy itself, like what the IAT can...
How dare you associate salt with pepper? That is so prejudiced.
Yes.
You're racist.
I've heard plenty of really wacky things about the IAT, like, or theories about what the IAT is really doing.
I want to explain about the IAT quickly.
So you can do this if you Google implicit association test. You can go to the Harvard website, and what you'll do there is there's going to be a series of association tests where on the left and right it'll say, like, maybe white and black, and then... Or it'll show a white face or a black face, and then you have to associate a word, a good word or a bad word, with that face. So, like, glorious would go on the white side, and bad would go on the black side, right?
Was glorious actually on there? Anyway.
I believe glorious was one of the words.
Okay, it was. Thank God. You're not just making them up now, right?
No, it's not the glorious PC master race.
Okay.
No, that was one of the words. So then it measures your speed by which you associate the words to the face or the words to white or black, and then when it flips it, right, how fast can you associate positive things to black faces and negative things to white ones? And you kind of end up losing out a little bit. It's easier for you to associate good things with white people and bad things with black people.
They don't tell you the interesting thing, or at least these articles didn't tell you. The interesting thing is, you know, it kind of, you know, maybe it's a little bit too much of an easy trick to say, well, white people always score poorly on this, or they never quite are able to associate black names as quickly as they are with white. The interesting thing is black people can't either.
Yeah.
Black people can't do the association test.
Yeah.
So,
I mean,
interesting stuff.
I mean, and that's pretty interesting data right there. I mean, what does that conclude? I mean, some people object to the IAT saying, like, it's something about, like, in-group, out-group biases and things like this. But things like this make me wonder if even, like, your own, the person you associate with, you're ending up associating, like, good words with white people and bad words with black people, even yourself being black. And, like, in articles this came up, too, like, the IAT correlates to different kind of real life patterns. What was it? I can't remember. There was a couple studies, actual scientific studies they did where the IAT correlated to. Oh boy, where is it? Damn you, Holroyd. I had you on here somewhere. There it is. Well, it's a bunch of stuff.
Well, you're looking for that. I mean, I just, even, am I the only one who noticed that when they flipped it, the orders, my speed just dropped, my speed and accuracy dropped up significantly, and then they threw, you know, the real one they're trying to throw you on is, you know, first they train you for white on right, good on right, right, and then they flip, you know, white on left, black on left, and all of a sudden they give you, you know, black on right, good on right, right, and black on, and white on left, bad on left. But the thing is, your brain has up to this point has been trained, I mean, to associate to put the good words and the white words together. And this is the game we've been playing right now.
You mean your whole life?
Well,
no, I just mean now. Okay.
Are you actually in the fucking tent? yes, of course, my entire life. You know, my entire life has just been, and it's kind of been a little bit more complex version of me putting, you know, black people on the right and white people on the left.
Basically, it's just you've lived the Ludovico treatment, like, your whole life. You're just in, like, a Clockwork Orange and images are flashing.
Wow.
I seriously felt that on that fourth round, my speed and accuracy just plummeted.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, is this because of bias, or is this because the tests have been training me to do one thing and then they flipped it on?
This comes up, actually. Some people try to say that, like, one thing this might be showing up is this fact that, like, you're suddenly, your inability to switch between two might be causing some slowdown in IAT. But, okay,
You're just motivated to justify your bad scores because of your implicit biases.
No. yes, that is a good one.
See how we're on dangerous ground already?
You were motivated to say that because of your implicit bias.
Oh my god.
Oh, it's in the inception.
We're all mind readers. Okay.
This isn't the racial cognition article. A recent meta-analysis of 103 IAT studies confirm that performance on the AAT is predictive of many types of behavior judgment. For instance, one study showed that subjects harboring implicit biases against blacks were more likely to interpret ambiguous actions made by a black person negatively, while another documented subtle influences on the way subjects interacted with black experimenters when talking to a black subject. Talk to a black experimenter, subjects with implicit bias toward blacks smiled less, talked less, and made more speaking errors. And recent work has shown that implicit bias can influence which prescriptions doctors are likely to issue to black versus white. There was that basketball study where, you know, but this is on both sides, where they called more fouls on black players and white refs did, and then black refs called more fouls on white players, I think.
Yeah, I'd like to know the answer, though.
The foul one, yeah. How many fouls were there actually?
Yeah.
I would have to actually take a look at the actual study to see if they controlled for that.
I just find it really disturbing that they decided the answer wasn't worthy of putting on there.
Nobody knows. Everybody knows fouls aren't real.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, my God. Basketball's a sham. Okay, that was the point of the article.
You didn't know they just learned that now? It's like pro wrestling, except like on a more advanced level.
I mean, usually they count the number of actual fouls. Then they show you the number of fouls the white coaches called on the black players and the number of fouls the black coaches called on the white players. But no, they're just like, well, white people called more fouls on black people and black people called more fouls on white people. Just leaves me scratching my head. Like, okay. And? And anyone want to tell me the truth now? No truth to be had. It's just only fouls.
Okay.
It's really walking in dangerous territory. That's why you got to be careful.
Yeah.
Well, you know, of course, granted, I mean, maybe this is an implicit bias on my part, but, you know, in Street Fighter 2, I tend to think that the big white guy is more likely to throw me, whereas the big black guy is more likely to punch me.
Wow, see, you're reducing him to his pixel or sprite nature.
Boxing glove pixel nature.
Fortunately, he can't transcend the fact that he's only got a couple of sprite sheets. So, Balrog's never going to be able to do the same things that Zangief does. So you can treat him like a thing, and I'm not gonna actually blame you on it. It's okay. As long as you don't think people are video games.
I did once kill one of my classmates, thinking that he could just come back to life the next day. We said, "Hey, wait, that was an incident that actually happened, and was luckily not by me." Okay, shit, that's.
You're already being educated well. So, like, I don't know, like, this is going to be the trickiest part, is when we go to the next step, which is basically, if someone digs their heels in the dirt and says, yeah, okay, implicit biases are bad, but I don't have them. Mm. Okay, so what do you say to this guy?
You mean he takes the IAT and he still says no?
Yeah, well, see, like, that's going to be one of
his... He just doesn't believe the IAT.
He just doesn't believe it. Or, well, okay, let's just pretend first he hasn't taken the IAT. Okay, so one of the first things we could say is, like, look, take the IAT. Why can't you do this? Right? Why can't you do this? And he's like, okay, so I couldn't do the IAT, so I might have a slight bias. Maybe if I was doing, like, if I was, for example, if I was hiring people by pushing the I and the E button really fast, right? Like, but he says, Dustin... I'm sitting in my office reading resumes, calmly. I don't have this time pressure on me. You know, I'm choosing the best person for the job. I'm sorry. What are you talking about? Mm. Implicit bias. What a bunch of garbage.
Then you'd have to give him, oh, wow, this guy seems pretty obstinate. I mean, you'd have to give him, like, two resumes, like, in different times, one with a white name, one with a black name. And then, like, show him how well he marked them with the white name and how poorly he marked them with the black name. And then even if who had the exact same qualifications before. It seems like this is a pretty obstinate guy, but...
No, I guess one of the first things we'd have to say to him is, or at least I'd have to get him to admit, is if you had an implicit bias, would you know it?
Ooh, yeah.
I mean, like, can you know that? Or, I mean, like, how would you go about... I mean, I guess he'd have to say introspection. I've looked inside myself, and I see no bias. Right, but I guess the next thing to do would be to say, like, basically, we'd have to play these kind of tricks and do surveys and stats and do real empirical data, basically. I mean, there's no other way to do this besides doing real experiments and sociological data, gathering it together, and putting out papers that say, in general, some people have these tendencies.
Mm.
Right? I mean, this is why it's going to be such a hard sell. Right? I mean, can't you see that, like, this obstinate guy that I'm talking about? He's actually, like, everywhere. Right?
Yeah.
Like, this isn't, like, just some weird guy I've made up. Like, this is, like, the average person on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, I don't know. It takes a lot of work to realize that sometimes your views are not your own. Or you're not playing with a full... You're not playing with only your own deck of cards. But that requires a lot of, I don't know. Some of it, I think that you can get this through introspection a little bit. I deny what they say all the time, is like, you can't get this through introspection. I think you can.
This comes up in the Holroyd article, though. Like, yeah. In a way, you can.
So, in an indirect way. You can.
In an indirect way, yeah.
They have to be pretty... The thing is, you have to be honest with yourself. You have to be open to the possibility that you are...
Well, racist?
Potentially, yeah, there you go.
Although, like, some of these papers deny that implicit biases mean you're a racist. But we'll leave that off to the side for now.
Mm-hmm.
I guess, I don't know, it's going to be hard work convincing this person that they possibly have an implicit bias. I mean, like, this is all psychology's work for the past, like, I don't know, since Sigmund Freud or even Schopenhauer. Basically, there's a split between the intellect and the will, right? And the more you come to realize that there are forces possibly working within you that you don't have direct access to or may not immediately know, I guess the better you come to know yourself.
Mm.
But I don't know. I don't think people like this, or maybe they see it in other... Again, I think they see it in other people, but they don't see it in themselves. They're more than willing to say, like, well, that guy, he's just sucking up to the boss because he wants to get more money, right? Me. I'm just, you know, I'm telling it straight with the boss, right? I'm talking frank. We're just being buds, right? So I don't know. There is a tendency for people to associate a kind of subterranean motivations to others as opposed to themselves. I don't know. I really feel like the next battle is this place. How do you convince this guy that he's got bias?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's going to be hard, I think. I mean, like, I don't know if you're going to answer this question here. I'm just wondering, what are you going to say to him? Well, I can say it right here if you want. You can convince me. I don't have any biases. I'm completely bias-free. Like, man.
100% bias-free.
100. Total rational. Like, Plato and I, we would high-five if we ever met. Like, just pure logic. Wittgenstein and Plato.
Gold sold. Yeah. Right there. Boom. Stamp.
Totally only moved by reason. That's all. Ain't nothing else going on here. I guess, yeah, the implicit, the IAT and other tests like that, or sociological studies. But, I mean, even these people admit in the end, like, what are these guys? The racial cognition and the ethics of implicit bias. They basically have to admit in the end, like, well, we can't really do this for everybody.
Yeah.
We can't really test everybody and tell everybody, well, you've got this bias, you've got this bias, you've got this level bias. It's impossible.
So you just got to make this kind of statistical leap, right?
So in other words, yeah, you have to take this kind of leap of faith that you are infected with the same biases.
Yeah. And if you don't, then you face the opposite bias of believing you're better than the average.
Yeah.
Then they hit you with that. Well, you think you're better than the average? Huh? That's just another cognitive bias.
A lot of people do think they're better than average, though.
Yeah. Yes, they do.
I mean, I know I do. So, I mean...
I was assuming I'm below the average.
Oh, wow, okay. Some self-effacement here. All right. Yeah. I was just joking.
That explains why you're more racist, Jesse. Oh.
Yes.
Ah.
I'm probably more racist than the master race over there, but...
Okay. Obviously,
yeah. Bias-free. I mean, like, I don't know how this obstinate guy seems pretty tough. I mean, like, so nothing he does ever falls short of his expectations.
Okay, that would be something you could say to him, right? Have you ever done something that you thought you should have done but you didn't do it?
Yeah, right. I mean, like, I would hope so. Otherwise, he'd just be like a god on Earth, right? Like, he'd be like the guys that what Frankfurt talked about, like these guys who have like no difference at all between the second order and first order desires, right? It's just suddenly everything is like obeys the second order.
I know. Just can't you see what I'm saying? Is that it's a, I'm not disputing the point. I'm just saying it's a real hard sell.
Mm.
Can you see what I'm saying?
Oh yeah, totally.
Like, okay, guys, now make a leap of faith. Basically, it's not a leap of faith. I mean, it's statistically like if you actually consider yourself part of history and part of why a part of a general culture and stuff, and you reflect a little bit and you even take these tests yourself, you can be more sure. But we can't do that for everybody. So you're basically asking these people to be like, well, I guess I'm that too. So now I should, like, for example, the teacher, right? Like, well, now I gotta mark every black paper up 20%.
Oh, this one is in the racial cognition paper.
Yeah, in the racial cognition paper. They're like, well, this is the gamble this teacher has to take. This teacher knows that there's racial bias out there. They knows that they have racial bias, most likely. And this accounts for a 20 to 25% downgrading in black students' papers. Therefore, to compensate for this possible racial bias that this teacher has, they will now effectively mark black papers up 20 to 25%. Okay. I mean, can you imagine heads exploding when I say things like that? I can. I mean, my head's half exploding. Like, I mean, what if the paper really is bad?
Then it would just go from a 0 to a 25. Ha ha.
There you go, right? Like, there you go.
So, of course, the other option is this teacher could just, you know, standardize the type of paper people submit their reports on. I got a black paper. I'm assuming they're using white writing, right?
Of course.
That sounds like it'd be pretty hard to read.
Exactly.
I'd be biased towards those type of papers too.
Exactly. That'd be kind of a cool world to live in. like these people, it's kind of crazy. These kind of crazy racial cognition, the ethics of bias. These guys, like, their solution is crazy, right? Because they're like, well, this person should gamble that and then mark up every paper 20%. Okay, first of all, you're kind of like, what? But, I mean, like, wait, maybe. But wouldn't the more appropriate thing to do, isn't there better ways you can deal with possible bias?
Oh, yeah.
And the best way to deal with possible bias is to do exactly what our experiment was, which was when you're grading papers, you cut the names off the top.
Yeah.
Right? That would be the best way to deal with it, because now you're not like willy-nilly marking up papers 25% because they're black. You just don't know who is who.
Yeah, yeah. It might even be better that to have them typed, too.
Exactly. Typed, so you don't see the writing.
Like, the font is all the same, right? There's no bias in, like, the writing or anything. And then you get a pretty clear look at the content without worrying about all these other little implicit biases sneaking in.
I mean, that's how they do it with, the London Philharmonic or one of those orchestras?
Oh, yeah, like, they play behind the screen.
They play behind the screen because they weren't hiring women, I think, was it? So they just put everyone behind a screen, and they just listen for who they think is the best, and that's it. I mean, like, I think people are more willing to accept that than to be like, well, this kid's black, mark him up 25%. Like, not saying I am, I'm just saying heads will explode. So, I mean, maybe there are better ways to deal with cognitive bias in some instances. Like, for example, I mean, like, too, like, when you're looking at resumes, too, you know, if it were possible to get rid of names and pictures, which I know you can't do, but it would seem to be the better solution.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, there could be other counterexamples to that, too. Like, I mean, like, for example, affirmative action. Arguments for affirmative action still aren't ruled out via that, though, by the way. And just in this case of, you know, bias in hiring people, in this case alone, maybe there are ways to make it anonymous that would seem fairer to a lot of people. I don't know. Maybe I'm making a bad argument here, I'm afraid. But,
well, I mean, at least with, you know, certain professions, you know, you'd have a pretty hard sell for total honesty. I mean, how would you deal with instances, interviews? There you go. I mean, of course, we could theoretically,
I have the perfect solution for that. We all just wear anonymous masks. And then nobody knows who's who. And then we blow up the British Parliament.
Okay. Oh, that sounds great.
No, I mean, I would be, was, you know, if it was for, you know, computer programming or something like that. Yeah, but if, you know, for Sabi Sagyo, right, I think that would be a hard sell based on, you know, because you want somebody who has the right, you know, is always smiling, you know, their eyes are, you know, they're not, like, crazily looking off in all directions because they're insecure.
You can see my smiling eyes here. Okay. I know, this doesn't work. This doesn't work for the service industry at all. Like, this won't work at all. Like for tests and some of the orchestra and computer programming, solutions like this will work, but in other instances, it just simply won't work. There aren't going to be any good solutions for this. There's just simply not, but there are better solutions in some instances. And these crazy people with their, well, let's just mark up every paper 25%, I was kind of like, well, maybe that's not the best solution here.
Yeah, I don't know, when I was reading it, again, I'm not sure if this is the best argument either, but, like, even they point this out. Like, the problem is, like, I like the sentence. This is the situation of the savvy grader. This woman, like the one grading a test, can be thought of as a rational impairment. Right? But I guess the point of being, if I can put it in weird terms, the problem is an epistemic one, trying to get the correct knowledge, right? So, like, it seems like if your problem is epistemic, like, knowing what is the real reality, what is the truth, how do you know that, like, just an automatic bumping up isn't as efficient as cutting off names, right? That's going to get you closer to the what the actual worth of the paper is, don't you think?
If that's what we're going for, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course, that's a pretty key distinction there, if that's what we're going for.
I mean, in some instances, they're simply not. For example, arguments for affirmative action aren't doing that.
Yeah. These are moral considerations.
Yeah, these are moral considerations, and these are different considerations. So we're not arguing that now. That's a different thing. So, okay. So, all right, so I'm going to leave my obstinate guy alone, and I'm just saying that's the battle that we're still fighting every day. So, and, you know, people don't believe sociology, and they don't believe sociological studies, and they were, you know, like, I don't think they're really prone to believe a lot of psychology either. People hate Freud. They dismiss these studies, and they don't like philosophy either.
Yeah. So, I mean, they make a lot of fun of psych just in general too.
Yeah, like, so psych is made fun of.
No,
it's not real. It's fake. It's all social science is a bunch of, you know, theory laden bull kind of thing.
Yeah. I've had people, well, to maintain their views, they've even gone as far as to try and fight against biology and physics.
Physics is going to be hard to fight against.
Yeah, well, it's like, well, you listen, you know, physics is theories are disproved constantly being replaced with new theories. Why should I believe the one,
this one
that exists now that's disproved my theory?
I just love the fact that when your view is being challenged, the level of skepticism rises like 1,000%. For other people's views, well, no. But, like, when you're challenging me, oh, my God. Like, my feet are so far in the earth, right? Like, I'm hitting magma, right? Like, there's no moving me now, right? Like, the level of skepticism is so high. I guess that's the problem with this. This is a tough sell. And even to me, who accepts this stuff, it's a tough sell. Like, I'm rolling my eyes half the time. Like, oh, well, now I take a gamble, and I have to be this humble, guilty guy who has faith in humanity. Why don't I go to church next week, too? Right? Like, I'm rolling my eyes. I mean, I get what they're saying, though. I get it. I totally get it. You do have to have a faith in the potential of other people. You really do. And you have to be humble about the fact that you don't know everything and you might have biases. I get it. But it's such a parody of itself. I wanted to vomit.
I like how that section where, like, activating your motivation.
Yeah, well, activate your motivations. Like, okay. Really? Okay, we're doing, like, self-help stuff now?
Yeah, gotta trigger the goal, activate the goal, right? So, to activate the goal, you have to feel bad.
Yeah, but if you feel like you completed the goal, you might have a rebound effect, right? Like, what are we even talking about anymore? But this is somebody who believes this stuff. Like, think of someone that thinks this is nonsense. I mean, they're gonna laugh. So, this is an early sign. The worst part is this is so early, right? We don't have a lot of good tricks and data and stuff to pull back. a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. We need more good empirical data. Mm-hmm. And I'm assuming we're getting that all the time, actually. As you guys can be seen from these papers alone.
Yeah.
So, okay, so now I guess we can say maybe that there's a couple things we can say to the guy that says, okay, yeah, well, having biases may be bad. But I don't. Okay, so now we told them, well, maybe you do look at the stats and stuff, and you can take the test yourself, and, you know, there are plenty of studies out there, and you can take a look at all these, and maybe just look at yourself a little bit and see if you've ever suffered from a kind of misstep between what you wanted to do, intended to do, and what you actually ended up doing, and you can see that, like, you're influenced by other factors that you don't know. Okay, so now, where do we go from there? Now we can go to where you were going.
Now we can go to, well, okay, maybe I have implicit bias, but that's not my fault, and my implicit bias isn't my fault.
Yeah, I can't control that.
Yeah, I can control that. What are you talking about? Like the greater, like what, Jennifer? Judith did here.
What bias do you have against Jennifer?
Stupid Jennifer. she's so racist. All right. Judith here, whose friend said, why are you blaming yourself? I mean, it's not your fault. It's not like you are trying to grade these papers incorrectly. It's just, you know, you happen to be born in America or whatever. And
well, she was the wrong generation.
The wrong generation. Oh, wait a second. That she should have been born earlier. like that would make it worse.
Okay, that'd be making it worse. Okay.
This is like reverse the wrong generation. Okay. She should have been the future.
She should have been going to the future.
Yeah.
Okay. So, she just happened to be born in the wrong time. Kind of a reverse LeBron generation, and now she, you know, it's not her fault. Like, I was born in the wrong time. Just like, you know, I don't know, the ancient Jews and the Japanese considered adults to be 13 years old at one time or another.
Yeah.
So, yeah, let's just say that a lot of crazy stuff was going on, you know, about 500, 600, 700 years ago. That's all I'm saying. Just think about it yourself. You know, what happens when you're an adult? So, right. And
it's the classic, like, oh, well, grandma and grandpa.
Yeah.
They don't know any better.
They don't know any better. They lived in a different time.
Yeah, it was a different time.
Yeah. Or what people will say about us in the future when it comes to eating meat.
Yeah.
Oh. Anyway.
I know.
Or charity, by the way. So they're going to say the same thing about us.
But the future where Peter Singer has like a billion children.
Well, yeah, this is the Peter Singer's got this huge mansion filled with animals, right?
just little Peter Singer clones everywhere.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
This future is coming, I think. Right? They're going to say like, well, you guys knew that animals experienced pain, right? And you knew that you were just getting this minor amount of pleasure from eating them, and you knew that you could pretty much live at least with less meat, and yet you chose not to. What were you thinking, right? I mean, this is a possible future. Mm. Now, what we were thinking is, and I think every day is, it's delicious. however, that's not a good
argument. That's a less delicious future you're imagining, too.
Yeah. Well, I mean, when I'm 3D printing my meat in the future, I won't have to think about
that. That's true, yeah.
So, I mean, like, maybe they're going to have a lot easier than we do, right? We can't 3D print our meat yet. So I'm assuming like the same thing is going to be said to us that's said about grandparents and grandparents. Like, well, you know, that was just the world they were born in. Yeah. You can't blame them for that. Now that comes the fun part. Yes, you can.
Okay. Hooray.
Hooray. We can blame people for being bad whenever they're born. Okay, why is that?
Grandma and grandpa are bad too.
Because you have a responsibility. You need to attempt to better yourself.
Basically.
So, like, yeah, this is what these articles are fighting. This is, like, the brunt of these journal articles are fighting, though. Like, I'm assuming most people's gut reaction is kind of like this. It's grandma and grandpa, you know. That was just their time. They couldn't help it. That's just the way things were back then. So, especially this whole, I think the Well, I mean, I'm going to put the Normie Arplay on outside of this, but like the best one is the Holroyd, Jules Holroyd
of course.
Article. Like the Normie Arplay one is great, but I should treat that as separate. But I did like this Jules Holroyd. You give these five arguments. One, two, three, four. Well, he has these five arguments for people not being morally responsible for implicit bias, and he tries to knock them out one by one.
Does a pretty good job, I'd say.
I would say too. You know, just of the five, there's the argument from the causal ideology of biases, the argument from control or lack thereof, an argument from lack of awareness, an argument from lack of reason responsiveness, and there's the argument from lack of identification, which he puts that off. But which one? I just wonder which one. If you kind of reach into your gut, which one would you go to first to say, you aren't responsible? Me, it's lack of control. That was just the first one. Just boom, right in my head. Like, how could you be responsible for implicit bias? You don't control that. I don't like on the test on the IAT.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not trying to. I'm physically trying to get the times correct. That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to get them to the same, but I can't. Yeah. And so this guy's gonna come up and say, "Well,
you bear a portion of the responsibility for that."
Yeah, you bear some responsibility for that, for yourself being like that.
I think immediately that would be the argument that I would run to. Like, well, responsibility or moral blame is an ought, which implies a can. And if ought implies a can, that means you should be able to control it somehow. And the responsibility, well, I can't. How can I change my implicit bias? And that's why they're implicit. That's why we call them implicit biases, because you can't change them.
Yeah.
Well, you can't. You can train yourself against it. That's right. And this is like people who swear. They can't stop themselves from swearing this time, but they can add the other association of the swear jar technique, right?
Yeah, you can do things like that. Yeah. You can do things like that. I mean, it's a little bit maybe more difficult when, like, your entire life you've kind of been, you have this Ludovico treatment where you've been seeing, like, one thing associated with another all the time. Like, so I don't think people really even know how to fight it, though. Well, first of all, they don't know if they don't have it, and second, they don't know how to fight it, even if they would. So he gives some hints as to how to actually fight for bias, but the first argument he covers I thought was a really good intro, which is like basically, well, it's this kind of, let's just call this a kind of superficial sociologist's view. Like, well, I like how this is never for our culture, but for moral relativists, they're like, well, you know, the Chinese are like this, and the Japanese are like this, and, you know, the Russians are like this, and, you know, that's their culture, right? But culture doesn't overdetermine who you are. I mean, that's the first argument. It's like, the argument, like, well, it's the result of being born in a sexist or racist culture that's why you don't have responsibility for it. You were born into a racist system, man.
That's just how they are.
How they are, right?
I like how it fits, the sentence feels more comfortable in that that's how they are, right? Because, like, you know, like these people, like you said, like people like moral relativists, I don't know, I think they have a hard time applying it back to their own culture, especially when it's like dominant ideologies and things like this.
Yeah, they can't.
They can't, yeah. I mean, I did like where he pointed out they got a tacit assumption in that, which is, well, if implicit bias is the result of being born in a racist or sexist culture or whatever, then the tacit assumption there is that we all have the same implicit bias.
Yeah.
And apparently that's not true.
And that's not true. You can just see it from the way any country is, America is, or if you go to any country, you can see quite obviously that there's a split between how people feel on different issues. So something's got to account for that split. And so in other words, you're not overdetermined by culture. And culture is not just one solid rock that a moral relativist or some kind of, I don't know, anthropologist can throw back at you and be like, well, you know, that's just the way they are. right? Well, it's not. It's just simply not. Because they're not overdetermined by that. So the conclusion is that the only conclusion you can draw from the fact that they're, and this is not a difficult point to grasp, but that cultures have infighting, right? The Japanese have lots of infighting, this we know. The Chinese have infighting amongst themselves about what is China, right? And the Japanese fight about what is Japan. And, you know, I don't know, the Iranians fight about what is Iran, or Muslims fight about what is the true Islam or something, right? I mean, this infighting is going on all the time. So culture doesn't overdetermine you, in other words. There are other contributing factors. All right, so that argument is knocked down pretty easily.
He did deal with this kind of really interesting thing about whether it's knowledge of... because this actually does come up if you check like Wikipedia and stuff. Like people, some people claim it's knowledge of these cultural associations. That's where the bias comes from, just from knowledge of it, not from you being biased. Just you just know that in your culture these two are associated, but you don't personally hold that, and that's why you associate them faster, because that's just the way they are in your culture. But he actually brings up some data, some research to show that that's actually not true. That if you view what you're doing as what he said, like if you view as yourself as different from the social norm, then your explicit and implicit biases converge more so. So in other words, like these people who are outside the social norm are the ones who are a little bit closer together, and that would not conform to the idea that it's just knowledge of what your culture associates together.
Yeah. Right. That was really interesting. I don't know. I haven't read the study, but it's a really interesting finding.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of funny that culture would be the one that would, like, split you. Anyway.
Yeah.
That's interesting stuff. But anyway, so moving on from that one, I think you wanted to talk about implicit biases beyond your control and how can you control your... What are some... 10 hints to control your implicit bias. Like a cracked article or something.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, Jesse, it kind of boils down to what you just said before, though. I mean, like, I guess the argument has to become, like, it's implicit biases we don't have immediate and direct control over, but we have long-range and indirect control over some of our implicit biases. And it does list some. What is it?
First one is obvious: exposure to counter-stereotypical exemplars or members of stigmatized groups.
Yeah.
Right. So in other words, just encountering people from other groups, or, I don't know, counter-stereotypical examples would be, I don't know, seeing a movie about a great black figure or something, or seeing a movie about a great, I don't know, Muslim figure or something like this, or actually meeting people.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
going outside of your bubble, meeting people, I don't know about that.
That's pretty extreme. Leaving my room, I don't know if I like that anymore.
Well, yeah, but the problem is that usually people don't reveal their race is on message boards. And so even if I meet them, I don't know whether or not they're a nice black guy or a nice Chinese guy or a nice Chinese woman.
See, you should have actually just left your room and chatted somewhere else. Of course, wait, if you leave your room, the only person you're going to chat with is a Japanese guy, so it's really not any chance to meet anyone else. Oh, it's funny. No. You can meet other people. If you come down to Tokyo.
Which I wish could happen more often.
So, like, this is one thing that, like, I don't know, for example... I don't know. I'll just be blunt. I think Japan has a problem with integration, or doesn't really know how to integrate people well sometimes. Part of that just simply is they don't have exposure to members of other groups. I think it's just as simple as that. And the same can be with, I don't know, people in the American South or X, right? There's just no exposure to it. And that's just the simplest answer, but it's just really difficult to do. Because it's kind of hard to deny someone sitting next to you. Well, I mean, you can do it, but it gets more difficult if you have a long relationship with someone to deny their transcendence, in a sense. Right?
Especially if they're doing something unstereotypical.
Yeah.
Like, if it's going outside of your association. So,
when you walk outside, it's not just Italians throwing up pizzas in the air.
It's Germans shouting. Gnocchi.
It's me. it's not bad. So there's that technique, and then there's, oh god, the next technique is cringy. Helmet.
Yeah, implementation intentions.
Oh god, cringe time. Get ready to cringe.
All right.
You can describe this one, because I'm going to, like, convict myself of something here if I talk. Wow. What is this one?
Wow, okay. Do I have to explain this one?
I don't like this one.
All right, well, so implementation intentions are, you tell yourself a conditional, which is like, oh boy, if I'm in condition C, I'll do X. So, for example, you tell yourself, if I see a Muslim, I will think, peace. And like,
sorry
yeah.
to laugh, I'm sorry.
And then, like, this has an effect on you that reduces implicit bias.
I don't know if I even can comment on this anymore. Words fail me. Program yourself.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I get it. I totally get what they're doing. They're trying to countervail a prejudice that's inside of you, but this is the most cringy thing.
I know.
Like, I know. Ever. Like, I don't know. Let's see if it works with knives. Huh? If I see a knife, I think Fluffy.
Fluffy. You're going to think Fluffy.
I get what they're trying to do. I totally get it. But I really like much more meeting stigmatized groups than I would be, like, pre-programming myself like a robot.
Really?
I mean, sometimes you... Anyway. I mean,
it seems like that's somebody who's been convinced already, almost. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
right.
Who's kind of sitting around going like, oh, geez, you know, I feel like every time I see a Muslim...
Can you imagine this person? Can you even imagine this person?
Like, this is the person who, like, after 9/11, like, totally is freaking out and, like, thinking, like, every time they see a Muslim, they freak out. But then they also think, like, oh, my God, I don't want to be a racist person. What should I do? What should I do? And then they're like, okay, I got it. If I see a Muslim, I will think peace. Like, this feels like somebody like this would do this.
Yeah. I mean, like, basically, this is the guy that's watching John Oliver. I mean, right? He's already watching John Oliver, right? I mean, it's going to be a hard sell for the other side, is all I'm saying. I get it, though. I get what he's saying.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
I get so. It. He says it like it really works well, too. I was like, oh,
I know, great, it works. Great. It works.
It's really effective when you brainwash yourself.
So, our audience, like, yes, now you have to think to yourself, if I watch...
Thumbs up.
TPS channel, I will think worthwhile.
Worthwhile.
Please program yourself. If I watch this channel, I will think it was worthwhile.
Right. Yeah.
So we need somebody to think that.
I don't like this method. I don't know. I don't want to say anything else, but I hate it. Moving on.
So next time you see this method, you will think, good method.
Good method. Is I have a very strong implicit bias against this. It just feels like it's so cringy and it gets right in your, like, where's the truth here? Right? Like, you have to already have a predetermined truth in your mind to get this thing to work. Anyway, I get what they're doing. I get it. But, like, how do you even have access to your inner states that you would be able to know how to counterbalance yourself this way? Or it sounds like this is a guy that's already convinced, like you said.
Maybe this does link up to the last one, though, a little bit, in the sense, like, the last one is unintentional, indirect control. So, yeah. Like, this is not something, how should I say, this is not something you, how could I put this, like, do, per se, like, at some time. It's you influence your implicit beliefs by your explicit ones.
Beliefs, yeah. It's like training for a tennis game.
Yeah. So I guess they found that individuals who endorse non-prejudice behavior for its own sake, rather than for instrumental reasons, have less implicit bias.
I like this one.
Me too. I did like that. I like this one a lot. Like this guy who thinks it's important just for its own sake to be a non-prejudiced person is getting lower scores rather than somebody like this example, rather than the instrumental reason person. If I had prejudice toward black people, I would be concerned that others would be angry with me. I like this guy, this instrumental person. You know, if I'm racist to black people, people are going to get mad, so, you know.
Yeah, but you know what? It's okay if it starts there. It just can't finish there.
Yeah.
Too often it finishes there.
Yeah. Hey, he's got to get more like on the level of goodness on Plato's scale.
Yeah.
It's going to get good for itself.
So that's going to be a tough sell to make for some people. Right? What's a good in itself, right? You need Socrates to come back from the grave to start doing these things. Well, justice, that's good in itself. I mean, it's also good in its consequences, too. But I'm a fan of this one.
Me too.
I've always kind of believed, like, this is what people react to in PC culture, right? So, like, well, like, this is why, you know, people can always get away with saying, well, PC culture just stops us from saying what we really think. You know, but under the surface, we're all bubbling, gremlin-like racists or something, right? Like, waiting to get out. And, like, you know, there's this underbelly of these people that perhaps actually exist. And they're kind of convinced that, like, the reason no one's speaking up is just they're afraid. When, like, you know, a lot of people don't do that because they think it's good in itself. Like, I'm not afraid. The reason why I don't say racist things all the time is not because I'm afraid.
Yeah. Just, yeah. It would really suck if people got angry with me. I mean, I hope it's not my motivation. You know what I mean? Like, I just don't want to be racist.
Yeah.
That'd be like the ring of Gyges. Like, if you could wear a ring of racism, right? Like, when you turn on the ring, like, maybe that's the internet, though. That is the ring of racism, right? You can be all the racist all you want.
The internet is the ring of Gyges. For racism. Right.
For racism. Finally, nobody can see me.
All forms of intolerance.
Well, that's not... I mean, some of it is just simply playing, but some of it really is that, right? It's a ring of Gyges for racism. I love that analogy. Good stuff.
Ooh. So, alright, that was kind of really the big one for me.
Yeah.
But, like, there was this other one. I mean, the other one that's really I thought was big was the lack of awareness. Like, how could you be responsible if you don't know it?
Yeah.
How could you be responsible for your own implicit bias if you didn't know you even had it? This is the other really powerful one.
This is again the obstinate man again.
Yeah, like, he doesn't know it, so, like, well, you know, grandma and grandpa, they didn't know any better. You know, in a weird way too, it kind of reminded me of, this is kind of one of the points I was almost trying to make in that Anita video that I made, like, where I said, like, at the end, like, the nostalgia critic said, like, you know, We should choose what messages to take from movies, but, like, I added that point. But you have to know a different way of doing things. You have to have another way of thinking about things in order to be able to make that choice in the first place. So, like, but if you don't have an awareness of another way of doing things, then you're just going to fall into that standard way, right? And that maybe that was supposed to be, like, the message in that video. That was supposed to be part of one of the roles of the critic, was to open up new ways of being, open up new ways of experiencing, that kind of give you more freedom in looking and seeing a thing, looking and seeing things. But this kind of runs a little bit askew of that. This argument, in an interesting way, this argument's going to try and say, like, no, you can be responsible even if you don't know explicitly that you're implicitly biased. Because I guess the argument is because you are aware. So the argument that you're not aware fails because you are aware.
That's the best I could make of it, too.
But I guess this is what they found. Like, these people did some research on this, and they found that people found that they were not living up to what they thought they should. So they felt like something was askew. Something was kind of zuriteru, right? Like, they couldn't quite get what they want to do and what they are doing matched up. And they even, like, it was really cool, like, well, they said, like, when they asked them, like, why do you think this is? And this is, they didn't make them take any tests. But why do you think this is? And they said, well, yeah, it's probably because I have negative biases. Right? They got it right. You know what I mean? Without this fancy-pantsy test, they knew already, just by guessing, that they was probably because of negative associations. So this is where this guy, where this hole right here wants to sneak in this kind of, you're aware something's off, probably. Like, your hands are a little bit too sweaty. You're not looking them in the eye just right. The conversation didn't go as smoothly as you hoped it would, right?
Yeah, I don't know if it goes, you know, it doesn't cancel out your other arguments so much, right?
I mean, not so much.
I mean, the critic can still broaden your horizon, hopefully.
Yeah.
Even if you don't agree with them.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't, like, wreck what I said in there. I just kind of really reminded me of, because that's kind of what I had in my mind, though, when I was making that part of the video. Like, why, you know, would it be right to hold these people responsible for things that they couldn't even know? Right, like, maybe isn't there, like, an act of liberation necessary? But, I mean, I get it. Like, how would you even come across this in the first place if you couldn't notice something was off? If somebody couldn't notice something was off without having to be told it.
Right. I mean, but there's going to be cases where it's tough. I mean, that guy that said that he knew that he had negative implicit biases already kind of implies that that value structure has seeped into the society already.
Yeah.
Right? But what if it was like, I don't know, what if some vegetarian said the same thing to you? Would you be like, well, yeah, I always suspected that eating meat was wrong. That's why I did it every day, all my life, even today. Right? Like, did you really know that? I don't know. So,
although, you know, like, I just kind of on that same vein, though, I do think, like, on the vein of charity, I do find my actions not living up to my ideals.
Now they do, right? Now that you've been exposed to these arguments, right? Those like before, it's like this pre and post Peter Singer.
Yeah.
But he was like, of course I knew that animals feel pain. Of course I knew that there were people starving. But maybe his criticism put it to you so directly and so almost irrefutably that it starts to torture you day in and day out in a way that it didn't before. I don't know. That's kind of how I feel anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right, though. I mean, like, post-reading some stuff by Singer, I have to say I think about it much, much, much more now. But there is probably some kind of faint awareness that something's off.
I mean, that's why we can have movies like The Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Right.
I mean, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre is kind of about the horrors of a slaughterhouse.
Mm.
And the horror of being reduced to an animal. So somewhere in there, in the unconscious mind, maybe there's some kind of associations being made. You know, what would it be like if I was made into a plate of meat?
Yeah.
Maybe it's rolling around there, but maybe people like Peter Singer can take that fear and just give it like a manifest form, right? Like that it's in your face all the time, not just kind of subtly like leather faces in the background.
Wow. All right, I want to see that paper. Oh. Leatherface and Peter Singer working together. all right, let's get on to the last big point we have to discuss here, which is so people who are implicitly biased, are they racist?
This is the weirdest thing of all. I don't understand this. I don't understand what their argument is here.
So you mean Holroyd or the other one, the ethics of
Whole.
Oh, yeah, that guy.
Yeah.
Okay, Jules. What's his name?
Jules. Yeah, I mean, because he's the one that basically suggested, well, you know, we can make this kind of distinction. Like, for example, an explicit racist, not even that, though. Like, just because you're implicitly have racial biases or sexist biases, you can't call that person racist or sexist. Because we have to make a fine distinction here between,
what did he say here? I want to get this right.
Oh boy.
You mean this?
Being a racist person and having a racist attitude.
Yeah.
Okay, now, all right, my mind is already kind of thinking, what?
Yeah.
So, I want to get your thoughts on this before I say something really stupid.
I know, this, just to me, it sounds like, you know, you're kind of dancing around it. You don't want to, you know, person doesn't want to, you know, say these people are, you know, racist because they don't want to start applying that label to people. Well, I mean, I've had, in discussing, saying, you know, racism in Japan with Japanese people, well, I once had somebody say that, you know, no, Japanese people do not sabetsu against as foreigners. They kibetsu.
Well, that makes it better.
That's even worse.
Yeah, it sounds worse.
Like, but yeah, I am from. Yeah, for whatever reason, yeah, this was, they just didn't want that to put that sabetsu label. So yes, we do treat them differently and in a negative way, but it's not sabetsu.
Well, it's even worse. So I'm glad he admits it. He's right on one of the counts. At least in his case, eh? again, he speaks for all Japanese people, as if you could. I guess the weird thing about this is, like, and but I get it. Now, I thought about it. It's like, well, you know, well, we wouldn't want to start going around calling people with implicit biases racist or sexist, because that's going to really put them off our issue. Like, he's running some kind of PR campaign now. Like, we're not going to get a lot of converts if we start calling them racist, are we? But, you know, and he's like, well, so we can say basically it's their views that are racist.
Yeah.
But not them. Okay. Yeah. I get this delicateness that he's going around in. But, I mean, like, even with the explicit racist, why can't the explicit racist say the same thing then? I mean, like, the explicit racist could be that. I'm like, well, it's just my views that are racist. It's not me. I guess the thing is, like, maybe racism and sexism carries too much baggage. Like, they're over-determining words now. Like, for example, if you called someone racist or sexist, there's nothing redeemable about them anymore, right?
Poison them.
Yeah, you've been poisoned with that label. Whereas, in actuality, that doesn't really mean that. I mean, like, a person can be racist and still have good qualities. You know, Hitler had some... Again with Hitler. Hitler had...
Always Hitler.
Hitler had some good qualities. But he was Hitler. So, you know, sorry to bring up Hitler again. It's always with the Hitler.
I think you have an implicit bias towards Hitler.
Yeah, something about Hitler.
Bias.
No, I mean, Hitler did love animals and he was a vegetarian. So, you know.
Got the trains on time.
Well, that was Mussolini, actually.
Okay.
get your dictator straight, please.
Yeah, we've got to have one good point for each one.
Yeah.
Your homework.
Yes.
No, do some research on Tojo.
sorry. With my, I was just stalling the conversation there.
Okay. Get those conversation trains going again now. Otherwise, we'll kill you. So I mean, like, maybe that's the argument here. I mean, I like where he's going a little bit, because he says, like, but he does provide a definition for a racist and a sexist, and the definition is. And this is where it starts to get even trickier. Mm-hmm. But he's like, only where such false beliefs or negative implicit biases are maintained, rationalized, and defended might we be more inclined to think that the individual really involved really is racist or sexist. So in other words, I have to extrapolate from this is a one-off comment here and there. But then if it's implicit, it's always there, right? But a one-off comment here and there doesn't make you a sexist, but... Like, taken as a whole, for example, a whole self, in a whole self view, if it's integrated into part of your character, then you are a racist. Is that his argument?
I see. Okay, this is where you're finally bringing it where in our play here.
Yeah, this is where I could fit it.
All right. Yeah, this is where it fits, though. I think this is totally where it fits. But, like, don't you think this guy is almost, like, more along a Frankfurt-style view? He's kind of like... Well, if your second-order desires are explicitly racist, then we can hammer you with the term racist. But if your second order desires are not explicit, then you seem to be in this, you just harbor racist beliefs zone. But doesn't the ARPLY article actually makes it a little more difficult to tell whether somebody's a racist on, like, based on their implicit beliefs? Because, like, ARPLY is about, like, this whole self-view. So, like, integrated. How well is it integrated in what you do as a person?
Yeah, I mean, at least at the very least, I'm more in that area, too. I mean, I kind of feel more sympathy for that view, personally, myself. I don't know about you, though.
The ARPLY
the
one?
The whole self-view.
The whole self-view. Okay, but I do want to ask, I do want to talk about this just a little bit. We just would so derail our racism conversation. But I mean, okay, the problem, let's just do it. There's no structure here, screw structure. The problem
we're done with racism now.
Racism's done.
Now we're talking about the real self.
Now we're talking about who you really are. Are you really a racist? What's your true self?
For example, like, I guess the person that has implicit biases and the person, and they say something stupid, is that the real them speaking, or was it a one-off not real them? Or I guess the best example is when you're drunk.
Yeah.
And you do something stupid. I mean, how do you interpret that? Is it when you're drunk, the real you comes out? Or when you're drunk, that's when you do something stupid that you never would have done in the first place, right? Yeah. So is that, when you're drunk, is that the real you or not the real you?
It's an in vino veritas thing, right? Truth in wine. Okay. So you're like,
okay. All right.
So like the problem is what? The ARPLY says that somebody like Frankfurt or a real selfer can't account for inverse acrasia, right? Like Huckleberry Finn.
bringing in the words now.
All right. Yeah. Oh yeah, that's right. Smart words.
Smart words.
So, smart words. Smart words. I have all the best words.
Can't stump you. You can't stump you.
I have all the best words. Isn't this weird? Okay, so Huckleberry Finn. Right? The example is Huckleberry Finn. And the problem is we think Huckleberry Finn is a good guy, even though he doesn't listen to his second-order desires. Like, he thinks he should be turning Jim in, but he actually fails to do what he thinks is best. He fails to do with the desires he identifies with. And then the way it's framed here is that, how did she put it? The problem is Huckleberry Finn. I like this. Look at this. Okay, Huckleberry Finn seems to possess two first order desires: a desire to turn Jim in, and a desire to help him escape. In addition, Huckleberry has a second order desire. He believes that his desire to turn Jim in is commendable, and thus he wants it to become his will. All right. Okay, that's a fine description of what's going on, I guess, but like, isn't what's really going on here is that Huckleberry Finn has two second order desires? So like, listen to this thing that's written early, that ARPLY writes earlier. Huckleberry is praiseworthy because he is averse to turning Jim in for morally significant reasons. Huckleberry cannot bring himself to turn Jim in because he believes in loyalty to friends. And while he knows that Jim, being black, should be treated differently from other people, he can't but help but experience Jim as human, and so not different from white people. So, I mean, isn't the problem that Huckleberry Finn is facing not that, like, he has two first-order desires and he's siding only with the turn Jim in one? She says, Normie ARPLY says, like, look, the reason Huckleberry Finn is praiseworthy is because he actually feels, and somewhere deep in his heart, that loyalty is the way to go, which is a second-order desire. This is what really kind of screwed me up on this. The goodness of Jim comes from two competing second, or sorry, the goodness of Huckleberry Finn comes from two competing second-order desires. I don't think this screws up the theory on a whole, though. Like, where do your second-order desires come from? I think that you could say, like, the reason Huckleberry Finn has these two second-order desires is something to do deep with his character, deeply rooted in his character, that he's even able to come up with these two. But this is my minor gripe with this. Don't you think? Don't you think, like, the freeing, like, she says, like, for example, if we knew that a boy's acratic failure to turn into a runaway slave were due to his a desire to rebel, to do things that are not socially acceptable in society, one would not praise him. So, it's because he has this loyalty in him, which I would call a second order desire. Am I totally just misreading this?
I kind of agree with you there. I didn't stop to think about that, but I mean, maybe he's taking this loyalty as just kind of a passing kind of humanitarian Schopenhauer-like feeling of empathy with his connection into the will or something. Like, maybe it's...
I guess that would be fine, but I guess the thing is, like, she says, she goes with her way, like, they go their way right in this article.
I know.
That, like, Huckleberry Finn is praiseworthy because he refused to turn Jim in for morally praiseworthy reasons.
Yeah.
Right? Because he believed in loyalty to his friends.
Yeah.
But believing in loyalty to your friends is a second order desire. How could it not be? How could, if you believe it's best to be loyal to your friends, that would mean you believe that your will should be one in which you are maintain loyalty to your friends. Mm-hmm. That could not be a first order desire. So I just think the problem is, and I don't know, I hate to disagree with somebody as well established, like here I am, this dopey guy on this dopey channel, disagreeing with the how these things are being phrased by, you know, somebody like really cool. I like this Normie Arpley, I like a lot, but I think this is being mischaracterized, no?
I grant you that.
Yeah.
I think you're right.
Mm.
I think you're right. I don't know how much that affects the overall.
I think the whole self theory survives this, though.
Yeah.
I think the fact that these two different, because then don't you, when you see it as two competing second order desires, Jim's desire to turn in, Huckleberry Finn's desire to turn in Jim becomes a desire to be a good boy. It becomes a desire to listen to one's elders, right? Which he also thinks is a good thing, versus his second-order desire to be a loyal friend, to treat people as human, right? And so then I think it makes Huckleberry Finn a more likable person because, oh, you're like, oh, well, you know, he does want to be a good boy. He does want to listen to mom and dad. But he's found there's even something deeper he's realized. Maybe he misidentified with this wrong second order desire, but somewhere he also has this morally praiseworthy.
He found a better second order desire.
Yeah. Right.
Right. He's a typical liberal now.
Yeah. Thank
he's
you.
Denying authority as a moral measure.
That's right. Down with authority. Yeah, Huckleberry Finn.
He's on his way.
Actually, I'm not against this whole self view per se, just the way this reverse acrasia is presented in the article.
Okay. Oh, I don't think I want to dispute that. I don't know. I thought the kind of thematic thing that was going through all these articles in the event, and I suppose we should kind of wrap it up here, is that all of these were trying to emphasize one thing, that the self... They wanted to take away the idea that the self is these kind of short-term moments, and that the way you control yourself and who you really are is the result of long-term strategies and measures, and integrated personalities. And that's so if you really want to focus on changing yourself, you have to change over long-term, right? And, like, I don't know, like, when it comes to some of these things, like, it almost seems like they're advocating a kind of virtue ethics here, a little bit, right? Because some of these people are saying, basically, it's wrong to have biases at all, right? Just having, like, some of these, which one, then? These guys, the racial cognition and ethics of implicit bias, they even want to go so far as to say, just having biases, even if you don't act on them, is wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, but that can only work in a system like a virtue ethics, right?
I actually, as much as like I'm actually for that, like some of their arguments were just
they're awful.
They were just terrible. Just absolutely. I had to reread and I was like, this is absolute. I want to give these guys the most possible generous interpretation, but like some of the arguments boil down to like, well, you know, you could. you could not use consequentialism. So.
Yeah.
That's what it was, and you're kind of like, that is that supposed to be an argument?
Yeah, it's just awful, right? I mean, like, and then we're left with either kind of like a Kantian, like, do your duty, or which doesn't work really here, it's very well, or a virtue ethics, where like you're not living up to yourself either as a kind of a full potential living up to your own virtue. It would be a kind of a fault that you would have to call each other. But virtue, again, is something else that has to be raised over long-term efforts and practice. And yes, even like kind of, I don't know, what that stupid, cringy, whatever, implementation intentions. You know, if you see a fight, break it up. Or you're like, if you see somebody in trouble, save them. Or if you're in the battlefield, I don't know, charge the enemy. I mean, like, you got to kind of resist your impulses a little bit and make yourself brave a little bit sometimes. I don't know. So anyway, I just kind of noticed that they really wanted to stress long-term senses of self over short-term.
So basically, when I give that 1,000 yen to the UNICEF people every Christmas, that doesn't make me a good person.
It might.
What if it's only one Christmas?
Oh, it was only one Christmas.
It's actually quite much more frequently. But what if it's only one?
Were you disgusted as you handed it over? You're like, oh, you were trying to, like, you were grabbing the money in your fist and you just wouldn't give it to them, right? They had to pull the money out of your hands.
I was putting the money in while I grabbed the wallet.
Well, I mean, that action is praiseworthy. I don't know if it's part of your character yet, though.
So. I would say it'd be more praiseworthy if you did more often.
Yeah. Like, I don't know if I can quite award you with the Medal of Charity quite yet, but good, maybe you're on the way.
The Good Guy Award, yeah.
You're on the way. Someone please tell me I'm a good guy.
Please.
Bojack Horseman. All right. So I guess that's all I have to say anyway, and we should probably wrap this up.
Yeah, it's been a long one. We should end this. So, all right. That's it. Thank you very much, and we will be back sometime in the future.
We look forward to your comments.
All right. Bye. Yes. Comments, please.